Good morning, Providence.
Good morning.
Hope everybody's doing well today. It's nice to see all those smiley faces out there. And welcome to those of you who are visiting with us today. Thanks for being here. We appreciate you coming by to visit with us. I'm here this morning to talk briefly about our stewardship campaign for 2020. And I just wanted you to know that sometime in the next 3 weeks leading up to December the 5th, Sunday, December the 5th, we're going to have a couple of new videos. And those videos are going to be done by groups and teams of people who have continued to work through the pandemic. It's incredible the amount of work that people were able to get done that needed to be done. And I'm going to kind of feature them over the next 3 weeks. I was going to start for sure next Sunday, but due to technical difficulties, that means that I didn't get it done. We're probably not going to have one next week, but the two following Sundays ending on December the 5th, we're going to have some videos for you to see. And I think there'll be a little bit of fun included in them as well. I also wanted to take this opportunity to let you know that on December the 5th, we're going to have Tommy Herndon is going to be our guest speaker that day. Tommy is well known throughout Virginia and North Carolina. He's been a pastor for over 40 years at a number of churches and is currently the director of legacy giving and stewardship at the Virginia Conference. So Derek and I had lunch with him one day a week or so ago, and he was very dynamic, very understanding of where the churches are today, and wanted to share some of his experiences with us. So on that day, he's going to be here to speak. December the 5th is also our consecration Sunday. I got confirmation today that the letters will be going out with estimates of giving on them, and a letter from me about what's been going on and what we intend to do in 2022. So be on the lookout for that. And now that I've said a lot about Tommy Herndon, I'm going to give Mr. Herndon an opportunity to speak and say hello to you.
Good morning, Providence United Methodist Church. My name is Tommy Herndon. I have served as an elder in United Methodist Church for 45 years, and now at retirement, I serve as a member of the Conference Foundation as Vice President of Legacy Giving and Stewardship. I've accepted your invitation to be your speaker for your consecration Sunday on December the 5th. It is my desire and goal to share my knowledge and experience of stewardship with your church. I look forward to seeing you on December the 5th. Thank you.
Let's give God praise for Tony for taking our stewardship and always doing an excellent job. Let's give God a hand clap of praise for him. Today is a great day. We got Sarah back. Jake, I want you to bring the baby up here. Come on up. Sarah, this is for you, but Jake, I want you to walk with me. Everybody, this is Daniel. We're going to walk down the aisle. And Daniel, this is your church family. And your church family, we're going to nurture you. We're going to love you. We're going to teach you in the faith. We're going to make sure you have what you need because we are your church. Amen? Amen. Amen. And some of you can't see, but he's got the Jake trait. Red hair. It's called the Jake trait. And we're just so excited about the Vogler family and Sarah for you to be back. And we are just thrilled at what God is going to do today. Thank you, Jake. Today is also All Saints Sunday. And so some of our beautiful brothers and sisters have gone on home to be with the Lord, but they're not forgotten. Amen. Not forgotten. And so today we want to just acknowledge them. And we're going to acknowledge them in a strong and a very special way. We also have Morris Hancock and Loretta Hancock. Would y'all just stand? Some folks don't know you. And they're going to be joining us today. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. And that part of our service will come at the very end, and by God's grace, we're going to make it very, very special. We're so happy that you have decided to join us. Today, my prayer is that something said will be meaningful for you. I pray that it would be so meaningful that you will leave this place wanting to talk to someone else about what God has done for you today. Only God can do it, amen? I pray today that whatever it is, you will give it to God. God's not intimidated by your circumstance. He's not intimidated by anything that's going on in the world. God can handle it. So today, this is the perfect place to cry out to him, to tell him what's really going on the inside. Now, the only thing I can say is you all look great and you all look wonderful. So I don't know what's going on the inside, but God knows. He's waiting for you to have a little talk with him. How many of you know that just a little talk with Jesus makes it all right? So throughout the service, just feel free to just close your eyes and talk to him. He's waiting and willing to listen to you. Ron?
Good morning, church. On this All Saints Sunday, God put this scripture on my heart to read to you this morning. It comes from the book of Hebrews, chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, where it says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that has been set before us. Looking to Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God." Our church members who have gone on to be with our Savior that we honor this morning have joined that cloud of witnesses. And let us give praise and thanks that they are with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We can celebrate that as we honor them this morning with the reading of their names as we honor our saints on this All Saints Sunday. James Yates, Charles King, Elizabeth Patton, Reeves Witt Jr., Curtis Bailey, Andrew Martin Davis, Hilda Lindsay, Rose Bradshaw, John Andrews, John Curtis, Leanne Jacobs, Carlton Gregory, Sharon Harris, Peggy A. Martin, William David Alderman. Lawrence Lee. Francis Driscoll. Charles A. Negri. Thomas L. Kaufman. We thank them for their service to our Lord and Savior while here on earth. And we give thanks to them as they sit with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We'll be singing, I Sing a Song of the Saints of God. And this hymn really takes a practical approach to sainthood and saying it's not just the bygone days or people that have passed on, but the Lord is calling us to live with the same kind of character and faith that those who've gone on before us have had as well. I didn't tell you which hymn we're singing. It's 712. I'm so used to not having hymn books, so my apologies. So it's 712. I Sing a Song of the Saints of God. So I'm going to give you a moment to open up your hymnal in case you didn't have it. Can we try that again? Let's start off with verse one with everyone singing 712. All right, here we go.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son, Christ our Lord. Grant us grace so to follow your holy saints in all virtuous and godly living, that we may come to those unspeakable joys which you have prepared for those who sincerely love you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Rick McLean, can you stand? Are you able to stand? I just wanted to acknowledge you. And I wanted to acknowledge your beautiful wife, Jessie. This brother just had surgery, open heart surgery, and he made his way back to church. We love you, and we have been praying for you, and it's so good to have you in the house of the Lord. God bless you.
And you may be seated. I want to add to this. I had the blessing and the privilege to join Rick and Jesse in marriage. Woo-hoo! And the next time I saw them after the honeymoon was after he decided to have two heart attacks. But God is good.
Amen.
And I love my brother and I love his bride. We have been friends for probably a decade plus now. And, you know, if you ever have any doubt that anything is possible with God, if God can bring a Yankee fan and a Red Sox fan together that they love each other, then God is able to do anything. So I just had to personally say my heart is full to see you both here this morning. God is good, and I thank God that you're here with us. And now, please stand as you're able for our call to worship. Through storms that rage around me, I will clothe myself with the whole armor of God. That's it. I will place strength and determination as my shoes to aid me in my ministry and mission for God. I will pray diligently at all times, offering prayers and supplications to God. Be strong in the Lord, who provides for your every need. We place our confidence and trust in God always. Amen. You may be seated. Let us pray. In the beauty of this place, we have come to pray, to worship, to receive healing and hope. We come from the struggles and triumphs of the week, needing to feel the soothing presence of our God. Lord, be with us this day. Come and soothe our souls. Cause us to rejoice that you have provided a special place where we may gather to talk of your presence and love, to sing your praises, and to be empowered to go forth and serve you. Amen.
Well, once again, it is so good to be back and to be here in person. We appreciate the live stream, but there's nothing quite like being here and seeing you all. So thank you so much for all your prayers for us, especially with Daniel having been in the NICU for about a week. We're just really grateful that he's doing okay and growing and keeping us all very busy. So it's just such a gift to be here. So go ahead and stand, please. We're going to worship the Lord this morning. And in the Psalms, David says, clap your hands, all ye people. people and shout unto God with a voice of triumph. And so I encourage you to clap along as we sing today, because it's one of the ways that we can worship the Lord. So these words, I believe, will be projected, so you don't need your hymnal, so we'll be good for that. So let's worship together.
Good morning, children of God. So nice to see so many people here this morning and to have the Voglers back with us. It's so exciting. This morning I brought along a little something from home, and probably most of you recognize this, right? It's a remote control. It allows me to sit in my recliner and make my TV do whatever I want it to do, right? Well, what if God created us with a remote control? And he could control everything that we did. We'd be kind of like robots, right? Going around doing everything right, being the best people we can be. But God didn't do that, did he? No. Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 and 27 says, "Then God said, 'Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that we may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground.' So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them." So what does it really mean to be created in the image of God? Well, Revelation chapter 1, 13 to 17 tells us that God can show himself with a head and hair, eyes, even a voice, hands, feet. I mean, pretty much sounds like he looks like us, or we look like him, I guess, right? And in a little while in the Ephesians verses that you will hear, he talks about putting on the full armor. And he talks about a helmet and the shoes and the belt, which again indicates that he looks a lot like us, right? But when he created us, he gave us a very special gift. He gave us the gift of free will, which means we get to make our own decisions and our own choices. But we still need rules, right? And God makes rules to protect us, and our parents make rules to protect us. And Jeremiah chapter 29, verses 11 to 13 says, "For I know the plans I have for you, to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." And the other story that you'll be hearing in the scriptures this morning is about Adam and Eve. And Adam and Eve were the first people that God created. And he created them to take care of the garden that he created for them to live in. And God gave them one rule. Anybody know? "There's this tree, guys, in this garden, and it has fruit on it." And God said, "No, no, no." But guess what? They broke the rule, and sin was born. And they broke the rule because Satan, or the devil, put himself in the shape of a snake and talked the woman into eating the fruit. And then she also gave the fruit to Adam. And that's when things kind of started to fall apart in our world. And God came in and he asked them, "What was going on? Why are you hiding?" And they said, "Because," and he said, "Oh, you ate the fruit I told you not to eat, didn't you?" So we all have sin in our lives. And I brought along my whiteboard this morning. And I have this nice permanent marker, which, of course, we know we're not supposed to write on the whiteboard with that, right? But just to show you, we all have sin. And we can change some of our decisions, and we can try to make things better by being better people and doing what we're supposed to do. But won't wipe away that sin, will it? So God sent us another very special gift. He sent us Jesus. And Jesus shed his blood to cover our sins. All we see is the blood of Jesus. And there goes that sin. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for sending Jesus. We know that all we have to do is follow him, and our sins will be taken away. Amen.
So Satan came as a serpent in that particular case, but I just feel called to say this, is that Satan comes in many forms. Satan can slither into your life through social media. Satan can slither into your life through the headlines of the news that is pounding upon us day in and day out. Satan can slither into your life through gossip, through lies, deceit. Satan takes many forms, but he does so with the sole and single purpose to distract us from what God calls us to do, what God calls us to be, what God would have us. So beware. He's out there seeking to destroy. He's out there. The first reading of God's word this morning comes to us from Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 20. The whole armor of God. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers and against the authorities and against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, having done everything to stand firm. Stand therefore and fasten the belt of truth around your waist and put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all of these, take the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always preserve in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly, boldly, as I must speak. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. Our second reading this morning comes from the book of Genesis, chapter 3, verses 1 through 13. The first sin and its punishment. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say, 'You shall not eat from any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die.'" But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself." He said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me the fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate it." The word of God for the people of God.
Can anybody say the blame game? Let us pray. Most gracious God, I am a sinner saved by your grace, and I'm still a broken vessel. But I know all you have to do is say the word, and I shall be healed long enough to do your work and to do your will. Hide this preacher behind the cross, that your people might see you and not me, that they might hear you and not me. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. For it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. Came across a story that in 1982, 40 scientists associated with the Research Institute in La Jolla, California, set up a small private company network to share ideas. Everything went well for 6 months. The participants were thrilled at their new toy and excited for their scientific potential. Then anonymously, a member of the group began to flame the others, sending obscene, taunting messages. Members of the group found their energy increasingly diverted, trying to get whoever it was to stop sending these kinds of messages, but they continued. The joy of the new toy was ruined. Finally, the 40 scientists had to discontinue the network. Stuart Brand related the story in the New Yorker magazine, says, "And not only did this break up this online community, but it permanently affected the trust that they had in one another. It affected their face-to-face relationships because they were never able to figure out who did it. To this day, they don't know which one of them it was. And so every one of them would look at the other and be suspect." They could no longer be trusting friends. They could no longer be open in their sharing in this fun work environment. They could no longer be unguarded in their workplace because one of them sent these obscene, taunting messages, and no one knew who it was. But that's the way sin is, isn't it? Sin destroys everything it touches. And it destroys our paradise just like it did for Adam and Eve. What am I saying to you? I'm saying sin matters. It does. I'm talking about the sin nature. That aspect of our humanity that makes us rebel against God. And when I speak of the sin nature, I'm referring to the fact that we have a natural inclination to sin. Given the choice to do God's will or to do our own will, we will choose to do our own thing. Somebody say, that's what's wrong with the world. Amen? Amen? But proof of the fact that the sin nature abounds, no one has to teach a child to be selfish. Rather, we go to great lengths to teach our children to tell the truth and to put others first. In essence, sinful behavior comes to us naturally. And the news is filled with tragic examples of fallen humanity. It's apparent that wherever people are, there is trouble. Charles Spurgeon said it like this: as the salt flavors every drop in the Atlantic Ocean, so does sin affect every atom of our nature. He says, it's so sadly there, so abundantly there, that if you cannot detect it, you've already been deceived. I want to challenge your thinking this morning with the thought, be strong in the Lord. Be strong in the Lord. I don't know, but we've got Morris Hancock here, you're another pastor, and maybe there's some other pastors in the room, but as we do the lectionary texts, and the lectionary text was read in your hearing by Ron, but I've preached to death putting on the whole armor of God. Maybe some of you are tired of hearing putting on the whole armor of God. Not that you don't understand what it means, but to be preached to by it. And so I sought to do something different. I want to take the story that Natalia read in your hearing, the story of Adam and Eve, and I want to talk about how the enemy uses strategies to defeat us. So for the sake of time today, I'm going to break this sermon up in two parts. Somebody say amen. Because I know you want to get out of here and say, ooh, Lord, praise God. He says he's going to break it up in two parts. So this is great. And so I want us to take a look at how the enemy tries to defeat us. But what do I mean when I say be strong in the Lord? First, it means that we must be reliant on the Lord. It's God's work upon us, not a command for us to find the strength within ourselves. Listen to what the Apostle Paul says. He says, finally, my brother, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. In the power of his might. So before we can start to fight any spiritual battles, We need to understand where the strength comes from. Amen? On our own, we couldn't fight our adversaries. But in order to fight the spiritual battles of today, I want us to take a look at this famous Bible story of Adam and Eve and take a closer look at these strategies that the enemy uses to try to defeat us. And I know you're saying, why are we taking a look at these strategies? Because the enemy doesn't have any new ones. The old ones work, amen? And so we've got to pay attention to these particular things. I love the word Genesis because it means beginning. So let's go back to the beginning. Genesis 3 tells us of this paradise that God had for Adam and Eve. Everything that they needed, it was provided for them. There's this beautiful garden. And in this garden, it was sort of temperature controlled, because the scripture says that they didn't even know that they were naked and they just walked around, but it must have been the perfect temperature. Everything was perfect. And God said, you can have all of this, but that one tree in the middle, don't eat from it and don't touch it. Because if you do, you will surely die. But the serpent came along with a different story. The serpent has many names. We might say the devil, Beelzebub, Satan, the accuser, the deceiver. I like that, deceiver, because that's what he does in this text. He lies and he deceives. So I want to share with you the first strategy that the enemy uses to defeat us. And then on next Sunday, I'll share the next two with you. Are you with me? So I'm only going to share one strategy with you today, but we're going to talk about it a little bit. So you know what I'm actually saying, since I'm going to be sharing this next week, you all have to be in attendance. You got that, right? So the first strategy the enemy employed was to tell a lie, causing Eve to believe that there was something she was lacking. This beautiful garden, temperature controlled. Eve walked around as she was created. God intended for this couple to live in peace and contented innocence, effortlessly reaping the fruits of the earth. They were to roam and live in abundance, to live in the presence of God. Everything that they needed, it would be provided. But the garden contained this tree of knowledge of good and evil, from which Adam and Eve were forbidden to eat. They lived perfect lives in this perfect setting. But note what Satan does in the story. He points to the one thing they don't have. You see how the enemy do it? You can eat of all of this in the garden, but just don't touch this. Just don't eat from this. And that's the one thing that Satan points to. God said, of every tree in the garden, you may freely eat, but not this one. And Satan countered God's prescription for simple living with a very simple lie. Satan's lie was so simple that it went right past Eve's defenses. God says, if you eat from this tree, you will surely die. But Satan says, if you eat from this tree, you shall not die. Just one word changed, but that one word made all the difference. you shall not die. Satan lied. He deceived. That's who he is. He's a liar and a deceiver. And then he went the extra mile, so to speak, to hook his fish. He established a motive for God to actually trick Adam and Eve. He says, God knows that in the day that you shall eat it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God himself, knowing good and evil. Verse 5. He bolstered his conversation with Eve with more deceiving lies. Can I put it in layman's terms? I wasn't there, but I'm using my imagination, if you will. Eve, God doesn't want you to grow wise because he doesn't want you to be as wise as he is. Go ahead. Eat. Surely God doesn't want you to ever really challenge him because he's God. He doesn't want you to be like him. Eve, go ahead. Eat. God doesn't want you to be great because that would threaten his greatness. Come on, Eve. Take a bite. Eve, listen to me. God knows that you can be great just like he is great. And he really doesn't want that for you. And that's why he told you that if you eat from this tree, you will die, but you're not going to die. Listen, he doesn't want you to knock him off his pedestal. Don't let God do that to you. This is your life, Eve. Be your own woman. Take charge of your own life. Eat the fruit and become somebody other than God's creative display. That's what the enemy does. God provides everything that we need, but you know what the enemy will do? He will point to the one thing you don't have. And the enemy will convince us to go after that one thing that will complete us. How many of you know it's never enough? It's never enough. There's so many people trying to be like their neighbors. Will go out and take a larger loan to get the bigger house just so that they can be like the neighbors. In debt, over their heads, because they think they're lacking something. So Eve, she ate. And once she ate, she knew. She had the knowledge of good and evil. She knew. And as I began to think about this, then she started to encourage Adam to eat. The scripture doesn't give us the details, but I have to use my imagination. So I imagined that it went something like this. Because you know, when you are married and you want something, you use the word honey, babe. Honey, take a bite. I did. It's really good. I can't describe the taste to you. You gotta taste it for yourself, honey. Come on, take a big bite. She probably bat her eyes a few times. You know she looked good. She was the first woman God ever created. Adam said, okay. And the only way to really know what this tastes like, you have to taste it. Listen, my friends. Guilt always seeks an accomplice. And misery always loves. Somehow, when we're doing something that we know that we shouldn't do, we want someone else to take the risk with us. Amen? And this is what happens in this story. But I imagine it as if Eve is saying to herself, well, I've eaten. I've disobeyed God. And he's going to kill me. And I'm probably going to die. But he created Adam first. So if I get Adam to eat this fruit, then maybe God will forgive us and back off. That's what sin does to us. When we sin, we rationalize our spiritual lives away. We no longer see the thing that God wants us to do. We only see what we want to do. And here's the problem with telling lies. You got to remember that lie. And then you got to remember that lie. And then you got to remember that lie before you get caught. Anybody know what I'm talking about? No, see, I'm the only person in here who was young who was spanked for lying. I'm the only one, right? I saw a few hands go up like, yeah, I got one of them. So Adam ate, and they both rebelled against God. They rebelled against the God who loved them, who created them. They rebelled against God who had placed them in paradise, against the God who had given them everything. They rebelled because they believed the serpent's lies. You shall not die, was the first lie. You shall be like God was the second lie. God is afraid of you, was the third lie. The serpent told them these lies, and then he hooked them at the point of their vulnerability. That's what the enemy does. He waits till we are hungry, maybe angry about something, when we're tired, and when we're lonely. And that's when the enemy comes to hook us, to get us to believe. So when we're hungry, when we're angry, when we're lonely, and when we're tired. What did I just spell? Halt. And that's one way we'll know to stop and think, because the enemy is coming to steal our joy or to get us something that we shouldn't do. C.S. Lewis says, not only should we look at Adam and Eve's temptation, but that we should focus on our own temptations as well. And so Adam became enslaved, he says, because he gave up his soul in an attempt to become like God. And so we too, like Adam and Eve, can become enslaved by ambition, by love of money, by thrills and adventure, by our power, by pride and envy, by our desires to be like God, by our desire to truly be in charge of our lives. And as Christians, we know that we cannot be in charge of our spiritual life, even in a limited way. We have to trust God to yield the increase in our lives. Now, I'm going to say something, but I want you to hear me in its entirety about what I'm about to say. You know that I love this congregation, and if you don't know it, then you should know it, because it's true. But even here in this congregation, there is the love of power, people's determination to have their own way, people's determination to control the actions of others, people's desires to be like little gods in their own little world. It's here in this church, yes, but it's in every church. Did you hear me? It's in every church. Because wherever people are, there is depravity. I don't know about you, but when I read the scripture, it says, for all have fallen short of the glory of God. That doesn't mean some. It says all have fallen short of the glory of God. We are depraved human beings. Can I just name it? It's in every church. And my friends, here's my point. There's a price to pay when we sin. Adam and Eve paid a high price. Don't pay a high price. I like what Ron shared with us in his opening, that Satan comes in many forms. And the goal is to take us off of our focus. The goal is to distract us. So many things that's happening in the world, and that's where all of our energy goes. And it's almost as if the media, the news, tells us what to react to. And we've got to be smarter than that. Daniel has given me some amens. Thank you so much, Daniel. I really appreciate that. But we've got to be smarter, amen? And that's what this scripture is telling us. To be strong in the Lord, in the power of his might, not within ourselves. Not within ourselves. Ron, would you come and close our sermon in a word of prayer? Doing this in parts?
So for those of you who don't know, the prayer that I deliver after Derek's sermons, I actually write it as he's preaching, so I capture his message within the prayer. So the delay was because I know this may be surprising, but Derek was actually shorter than I thought he was going to be, so I wasn't finished writing yet. Church, let us pray. Dear God, O merciful Father, in 1 Peter, you tell us to be alert and of sober mind because the enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. May we know and understand that we must always seek to be strong in you, our Lord and Savior, for being strong alone will have us always fall prey to the evil one. While it is human nature to seek someone or something to fault and blame, let us always understand that every crime of sin in the history of mankind is ultimately an inside job. May we understand that we must daily equip ourselves with the full armor of God so that our strength and protection comes from the Lord and is not of man. For defeat of Satan
is dependent upon this choice that we make. May we always remain immersed in you so that we can resist the deceit and temptations of the evil one and continue to live our lives in your glorious word, resounding to Satan that whatever he is selling, we aren't buying. For all that God provides is sufficient. You see, your grace is sufficient. Your blessings are sufficient. Your love is sufficient. But church, we can never be complacent. We can never rest, for each day Satan seeks to destroy. Every day we need the full armor of God. Every day we must be strong in the Lord. And it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Even as Pastor Ron was praying, I was thinking about the song that we sang earlier, saying, every day it's you I live for, every day I'll follow after you. And every day it's a choice, just as Pastor Derek was saying, to watch out for those signs that the enemy's trying to steer us off. It's not that we've arrived and, you know, we can just not be vigilant. We have to be vigilant every day. And one of the things that we can also do is remember who we're putting our hope and our trust in, and knowing that if Jesus came and he was born and he died on the cross and rose again, then surely he will come again, even as he has promised that. So that's what we're singing right now, is Days of Elijah, and focusing on the fact that he is coming back. So please stand as we worship together.
seated. This is a wonderful time in the life of the church where we get to participate through the giving of our tithes and our offerings. There's so many people plugged in via live stream, and we want to say thank you to you, those who continue to give. We don't want to take away that opportunity. Maybe you're watching us for the first time, or you decide that you want to give and you're saying, well, how do I do that? Go to providenceumc.net/giving and follow the tabs. Or if you want to make a check out to Providence United Methodist Church, the address is 901 South Providence Road, North Chesterfield, Virginia, 23236. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for all that has been given and all that will come. Even in our giving, you have blessed us. And we're giving out of the abundance that you have blessed us with. Father, thank you for making us cheerful givers. Thank you for being so faithful to this church, lo, these many years, since 1807. The names and the faces have changed, but your spirit is the same, causing us to be a beacon right here in this community. So, Father, we give you praise and we give you thanks. We ask that you would take what we have received and that you would bless it and break it so that it would feed the multitude who stand in need of this ministry. We pray it to be so in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, amen. Jolie, come on up here. So I'm going to ask Morris and Loretta Hancock to come on up, and whoever would like to stand with them can come. And I want my prayer team to come on up. They know what their roles are. But I want to say to you that Morris Hancock is a retired United Methodist pastor. And the conversation that he had with me was there's not a lot of churches who wants a United Methodist pastor retired. And I told him, nonsense. You come here. This is the house of the Lord. You are welcoming. What would you say to that, Jolie?
You know, I would say that any church is blessed to have a retired pastor because you have a heart full of love to give. But more so, we're blessed to have the wife of a retired pastor because a pastor's wife has to give sacrifice after sacrifice because you give his time.
Page 38, I'm going to tell everybody.
So we want your heart full of love too. And I think that we're happy and blessed to have you both here. And I'm just very thankful to meet you and see your faces.
Praise God.
Amen. Pass it to Yanetta. I want you all to turn your hymnals to page 38. Yeah, stand in front of them, Yanetta.
Good morning. Welcome. Almighty God, by the love of Jesus Christ, you draw people to yourself and welcome them into the household of faith. God, we show your joy by embracing Mars and Loretta Hancock and welcoming them as new members to Providence United Methodist Church. As we bear your creative and redeeming word to all the world, God, we ask that you will keep us close together in your spirit, in the breaking of bread and the prayers, and in service to others, following the example of Jesus Christ, our servant and Lord. Amen. We welcome you.
As members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service. You may respond by saying, we will.
We will.
Okay, that's you.
Members of the house of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love.
We give thanks to all that God has already given you,
and we welcome you in Christian love as members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service. May God be glorified through Jesus Christ.
Amen. Gene, the microphone for Gene. Gene.
Loretta, we have some, I don't know if they can hear. Can you hold this while I do this? Hold this a second. Hold that too. Thank you.
Loretta, we have a shawl made for you by one of our members. No, don't wear shawls. Sorry about that. Isn't that precious?
Yes.
I know.
And we have some words that we want to share with you. May you receive this shawl and wrap it around you both. May this shawl be a safe haven, a sacred place of security and well-being, sustaining and embracing in good times as well as in difficult ones. Rest within its softness. May you be cradled in hope, kept in joy, graced with peace, and wrapped in God's love. Amen.
Let's pass the microphone to Althea, and she's going to pray us out. Yeah.
Surely the Lord is in this place. Let us go to the Lord. Oh, eternal and loving God, the members of this household of faith praise and thank you for Morris and Loretta, who come before your altar and have expressed their desire to continue their Christian journey with our congregation. May their service and witness bring you honor and glory. I pray that their reception today may be a reminder that we are all ambassadors for Christ. O Divine One, may our love for your Son encourage us to boldly tell the story of Jesus and his love. In your word, you require us to act justly and love mercy and to walk humbly with you. As your children, we will join hands with Morris and Loretta and walk together in spirit and truth. In the mighty name of Jesus the Christ, and the people of God say, amen.
Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. We have a basket for you that was put together with much love. I could say that I put it together, but you would know that I'm not telling the truth. And I just got finished preaching about telling the truth. So, Yonetta, raise your hand. She put this basket together. And so we're going to carry it to the back for you. As we go, we want you to be at the back door. You may not be comfortable with shaking hands, and if you are, that's fine. But we're going to do holy fist bumps and holy elbows. All right?
We don't mind
handshakes. Amen. So please stand for your benediction. One note that we didn't, today is the last day for CHASM. So if you want to write a check in the memo line, please put CHASM. And I want to thank Pam Asbury for reminding me, because Shirley Hudson would have my head if I did not mention it. So thank you. So today is the last day. If you want to write a check in the memo line, put CHASM. Okay? May the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. May the Lord lift your countenance and grant you all God's great peace. Be at peace and go in peace. I'm going to ask you to be seated again, and then the ushers will have us leave according to the protocols. You guys are going to go to the end of the door with Ron, and we'll shake hands, or holy fists, holy elbows.